So speaking of last night, you had a cameo on your son, W. Kamau Bell's show, United Shades of America. And I want to say thank you because something you said and something that Daryl Davis said, who was also the jazz or the blues pianist, something you both said really resonated with me. And it basically had to do with what Ian and I have been talking about all along with, you know, on World Footprints, is the connection power that travel has, the ability for travel to not only change your preconceptions about other people, but really showcase our common humanity. And I'm so grateful because during this time, this crazy time with social unrest and COVID-19, I've been struggling with this message, how to keep this relevant, or even if it is relevant. And what you said and what Daryl said on the show last night validated the message that we share with on World Footprints. So thank you.
Glad to be of service.
Now, we're dealing with a lot in this country. It seems like we're going through a racial reckoning of sorts, where the chickens have essentially come home to roost, as we've seen since the death of George Floyd. And a lot of people would say, well, you know, the civil rights movement, we've made some steps forward, we've gone back, and here we are having lost a tremendous figure in John Lewis. And he would often remind us that the civil rights movement has made progress, has brought some significant changes in America. And you were there as a product of that time, seeing firsthand what was going on in the 60s and so forth. What would you say today about where we are as a nation?
Well, I think the biggest change is that the civil rights movement of the 60s opened up a lot of opened up access to some economic power that Blacks had not had previously. I mean, what I remember most about the results of that movement, and it didn't happen overnight, it took years of plugging away at it. Affirmative action came out of that, and that allowed Blacks to have a lot of access to employment that had not been available prior to that. And as a consequence, Blacks were in positions where we had never been before, because prior to that, most of the jobs that Black people held, except for rare occasions, were menial jobs, you know, domestic service, janitorial work, that kind of thing. But, and that also opened up more educational opportunities for Blacks, because they began to see that if they got an education, they could actually use it. When I was growing up, lawyers had jobs in the post office because they couldn't get jobs with law firms. So Black people didn't see that getting a college education was worth much. But after the 60s, when an affirmative action and those things happened, Blacks were hired in some places where they had never been hired before. And I know this from personal experience, because nearly every job that I had in my entire life, I was the first Black person to hold that job. Which is ridiculous, but true. And so now that we're having this new sort of reckoning, as you referred to it, Blacks are feeling more powerful in their demands for new accountability than they were feeling 50 years ago. So I think we're approaching it on a different level than we were 50 years ago, because first of all, there are all these Blacks in positions of power within the media, not nearly enough, of course, but there are some who are able to create a different media image of Black people than has ever been created before. And there are Black people on camera who are speaking to issues in a way that most news people never spoke about them before. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, I think my son's show, The United Shades of America, where he shows what they have dubbed intersectionality, where he shows that all of us who are oppressed have the same enemy. And as a consequence of that and our current president's ability to offend everybody except for a small group of his supporters, we're beginning to understand that we have more power if we stand together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, small group of supporters until they disagree with him, then it's another. Yeah, story.
Yes, yeah. Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Janet, I'd like to explore with you, given where we are, and I reflect back to the late Ralph Wiley, who wrote a book, What Black People Should Do Now. What do you think Black people should do now, given where we are?
I think we should continue to be cognizant of our power and to continue to cooperate with other oppressed groups and build coalitions and work together to topple that little white male patriarchy that has been oppressing everybody. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's what I think we should be doing now.
Are you seeing anything new or different during Black Lives Matter movement? Namely, well, are you surprised that it has taken on a global movement?
I was surprised at that. I was very surprised at that. But again, I think that has a lot to do with the technology of our media nowadays too, is that whatever happens anywhere in the world, the rest of the world can find out about it instantly, mm-hmm. whether it's on television or not. It used to be that we had to wait for television to get our news or radio. But now we don't have to wait for that. The news is instant on, because people all over the world are hooked into Twitter and Facebook and all of these social media things.
So is anything new happening here that you're seeing that didn't happen during the Civil Rights Movement? Or do you see, I know there's a lot of similarities, but are there some differences you see as well?
Well, the big differences are that the earlier Civil Rights Movement was nearly all Black. I mean, there were a few white people, of course, but not to the extent of the white people who are involved in it now. And also, more young people are involved now. Although there were young people involved then as well. As a matter of fact, most of them were young, because the older people were sort of like, don't rock the boat, you know. but there's definitely, it's a more diverse group, definitely. And all these young people really give me hope, because they are the future. I mean, all of these old white men who are digging in their heels, they're not gonna live forever. So the young people who are involved really give me hope.
Mm-hmm. Now, Janet, you are a prolific writer, having written a dozen books, and I understand your books are now flying off the shelves, if we can say that, since we don't really have bookstores anymore, but I guess they're being packed up by Amazon and going all over. And tell us about this stage of your career, given where you started in this area of African-American writing, African-American studies, and now there's such a demand and such a hunger to read these essays and read these books that you've had. It's gotta be pretty gratifying.
Yes, it definitely is. It's also kind of amusing to me because, you know, I mean, some of these books have been out there for so long and were roundly ignored. So it's kind of amusing to see, well, I guess I was ahead of my time. What can I say? but I'm very gratified too. I'm glad to see that people are reading my books. I really appreciate that.
Now you, I know you're writing a play as part of a project. Tell us about that. And I think you mentioned you are writing, you haven't written for a while, or you haven't done a book for a few years, but you're still writing.
Yes. The last book I published was 2 years ago, but there's usually a lot of space between my books because it takes me a long time to write them. Because usually my books, I do a lot of historical research because I've only written nonfiction prior to writing this play. And I do a lot of research to make sure that my nonfiction is accurate and that I'm, you know, because although my memory, I think, serves me pretty well, sometimes it gets a little skewed. And so I have to check the records to make sure, is this how it happened or did that happen first? So it takes me a while to write a book. So I probably, another couple of years, I'll have another book out.
Excellent. And what about your play? Do you have a...
Well, I'm working on the play right now.
Okay.
And this is my first time ever writing, you know, creating something out of whole cloth without, you know, usually I'm writing about stuff that I've had experience with. Mm-hmm. And this, I'm just making it up as I go along. And so it's a challenge. It's a challenge. I think I'm putting some more grooves in my brain.
Can you give us a little exclusive on your play?
All I can say is that it's will not venture far from the subject matter of the rest of my material.
Okay. And your material is very, very extensive. So maybe I'll do a little bit of research and try to connect the dots.
Now we're hearing a lot about words and stylistic things that speak to the moment in which we find ourselves, like, you know, we're having this huge conversation over whether mainstream media should capitalize the B in black and revisiting words that may have origins drawn from the colonial era, racism, sexism, and so forth. What do you think about all of this stuff and kind of revisiting language within the times that we find ourselves?
I think it's great because language shapes how we think about things. So I think it's absolutely essential. And of course, I've lived through many iterations of what Black people are called. I remember the whole brouhaha over whether or not to capitalize Negro. And they decided that it should be capitalized. And then later we decided, no, we don't want to be called Negroes anymore. We want to be called Black people. And so, yeah, I think it's necessary. And also, the thing that I think is most important is that people get to name themselves and not have to labor under a label that somebody else has foisted on them. So if a group of people says, do not call us Redskins because we find that offensive, and do not name your sports team Redskins because that offends us, they should be respected and listened to. And it's really unfortunate that it took so long for that to happen. But yeah, and I think the statues that praise traitors to the United States should be pulled down. Yes, I agree with all of that. Because when you know better, you're supposed to do better.
Right. So in where we live in the travel space, there's been a lot of dialogue between travel journalists who, you know, question the new AP rules, you know, capitalizing Black, not capitalizing White when referring to a group of people. But then other words like antebellum and Confederacy, you know, when people are writing about the South, I know there's a lot of confusion about how should I refer to a Confederate home or a plantation or an antebellum home. And when performers are changing their name, like Lady Antebellum is removed antebellum from their name. Do you have any thoughts on those types of sensitivities and how they should be treated?
Well, I mean, if Lady Antebellum wants to change their name, I don't have a problem with that. I didn't have a problem with them calling themselves Lady Antebellum either. What that said to me was that, oh, this is a Southern group. Maybe they aren't, but that was what it said to me. Oh, this is a group from the South that wants to elevate their kinship to the antebellum period. That's how I interpreted it. And it also said to me that I'm not interested in that group. And so if they do want to appeal to everybody and not just people who find that acceptable, then I think it's a good idea for them to change their name. Mm-hmm. The whole thing about capitalizing Black and not capitalizing White, I'm not sure what that to me doesn't seem fair. I mean, if you're gonna capitalize Black, why not capitalize White? I don't understand the reasoning in that. I mean, I accept my son said, if we capitalize the Klan, we should capitalize Black.
Oh my God. Yeah, he has a point.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're not traveling much now because of COVID-19. None of us are. We've been cooped up in our homes. Mm-hmm. But in terms of your travels, and I know you've traveled extensively, how have your travels informed your writing over the years?
Well, let me just say that the very first, well, my family traveled a lot as a child. We went on trips to historical places and went to parks for picnics and things like that, and we visited other family members. But the first travel that I did that really sort of opened me up was when I moved from my hometown of Indianapolis to another state for a job. And for me, what that did was it liberated me to be completely myself, because nobody in this new place knew whose daughter I was or whose sister I was. And they didn't have any preconceived notions about who I was. Mm-hmm. So I could be whoever I wanted to be. And so that felt very liberating to me. I think I wrote about it one time, said I felt like Frederick Douglass when he escaped slavery. You know? I'm a whole new me. Mm-hmm. and it helped me to learn how to meet new people and without fear and without preconceived notions. So that was very liberating for me. Traveling to other countries was liberating in another way, because I learned that people are the same everywhere. They have different cultures, different mores, but the human nature, I mean, being human is the same everywhere, and it has nothing to do with color or culture or any of that. So, so that was, you know, traveling as they, there used to be a cliche, traveling is broadening. I agree. It is.
Yeah. Yeah, I think your stories there really resonate with us. And just hearing you talk about leaving Indianapolis, and as I understand your, that job that made you leave Indianapolis took you to Michigan, correct?
Yeah.
And for me, I had a similar experience. I went from my home area here in the DC, Maryland, Virginia area, and I moved to Michigan. And the same feelings that you mentioned about being free, being liberated, no one knowing you, it allows you to reset and reinvent yourself. And I haven't looked back since, and neither have you. So I really appreciate you sharing that.
And from my perspective too, you know, living overseas, I mentioned I had lived overseas. Being a person of color overseas was it was very liberating. We actually just posted an article about Black American travelers who are happier and feel safer right now overseas. And
yeah,
one of the people interviewed said that there's a lot of power and empowerment in our little blue passport, because when people learn that you're an American, their tone, their energy, everything, it changes. And it's almost like they, you know, they give you preferential treatment, you know, they show some deference where mm-hmm. they're, you know, where they wouldn't before. And I think, you know, we saw a lot of that with artists back in the 40s and 50s and 60s leaving this country because they found a home overseas.
Right.
Yeah. Now, is there, from your all of your overseas travel, is there, what is your most memorable or transformative trip that you've taken?
That's a good question. I guess probably when I went to Nigeria, because, you know, one of the things definitely at the number one top of my bucket list was going to Africa. And so when I went to Nigeria, it was, it satisfied something in my soul that I needed or wanted to experience. But it also showed me how much alike fundamentally those Nigerians were to American Blacks.
Mm-hmm.
And that was very, you know, informative. I remember going to what they called a New Yam Festival in Nigeria. And even though I couldn't understand the language, the rhythms and the call and response were exactly like the Baptist church that I had grown up in.
Now, sounds like you may have segued into our next question, but do you have a soul country, a place that you've been, you mentioned Nigeria, that really speaks to you or has spoken to you?
Feels like home, just home away from home.
No, I can't say that I found that in another country. But the first time I came to the Bay Area in 1970, I felt this was home.
Hmm.
And this is my third time living here. And this, I'm not moving anymore, so this is where I'm going to die. unless I happen to be on the road or something. But this felt like home to me. And it was really sort of like surprising and reinforcing or gratifying when my son decided, because he was born when I was living out here the first time, but then we left when he was about 8 months old. But when he became an adult, he decided he wanted to go live in the Bay Area. And we were really surprised. Like, oh, something in him wanted to go home, you know. but I can't say that I've had that feeling in another country.
You told me that one of the things, you know, still kind of maybe on your list to try is to live abroad, or at least to have a place. Do you have you chosen where you'd like to live abroad for a little bit?
Well, you know, the only European country that I have ever wanted to visit, and I still would like to do that. I don't know if it's going to happen, is Spain. Mm-hmm. And that is where I would like to go live. I'm not sure why, because I don't even know how to speak Spanish, although I know I can possibly learn. As a matter of fact, I think when I finish writing this play, I'm going to learn Spanish. I will get ready so that when I go to Spain, I can at least speak the language.
Absolutely. Oh, well, you know, I mean, the rhythms there too maybe resemble more of an apostolic church, you know, Pentecostal church. So you'd still find a home there. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to end with a kind of a rapid fire question that we always love to ask our guest. Mm-hmm. And that is, when the world resets and we can all go back out and travel, when it opens up to us, if you could choose anyone, either past or present, to sit next to on a long haul flight, maybe to Spain, who might that be?
Maya Angelou. Yeah, she didn't know it, but she was my mentor. I just like, first of all, I like the fact that here's a Black woman who doesn't fit any of what we call our standards of beauty, but who was one of the most beautiful people who ever walked this earth. And brilliant and prolific in terms of her production. I mean, not only in terms of writing books, but in performing and speaking and making movies. I mean, she was a Renaissance woman. And I did meet her a couple of times, but it was at book signings where she just signed my book and I moved on. So I never really had a chance to talk with her, but that's somebody that I would really like to talk with. And I love the fact that she did not tolerate bigotry or profanity in her home. I love that. Mm. Yeah, so she would, the only other person, if I couldn't have Maya, would be Ida B. Wells. Mm. Yeah. She's my, Ida B. Wells is my activist mentor.
You can have, you know, more than one mentor, and it satisfies every interest in your life.
Yeah.
Oh, Janet Cheatham Bell, thank you so much for joining us today. And
thank you for having me.
It is our pleasure. And we thank our audience as well for tuning in.